Good morning. I'm Pastor Carrie, and I'm glad that you are here to worship with us this morning. I would love for you to take out your iWorship Today sheet and just let us know that you are here. Note that there's a host of things on the bottom, and we will talk about those later in our announcements. Our first announcement up on our screen is that the National Youth ELCA Youth Gathering, it is here. We will leave on Saturday with a group of eight of us to head out to New Orleans for the pre-gathering event. And then we will have six more who are joining us flying on the 16th for the main gathering. And so we ask, as we gather with about 16,000 other youth and their adults, that you hold all of us in your prayer as we travel, as we worship and serve and have fun together. For those of you who have never been to a gathering, who want to see kind of what a gathering is, they will actually be live streaming the gathering on the 16th through the 19th from 7 p.m. until 9:15 p.m., which allows you to see worship speakers and kind of have that atmosphere of the gathering. And then on Saturday morning on the 20th from 9 to 11:30, we will have our final gathering, and that also will be live streamed. There's more about it in your bulletin with the link to the website where the live streaming should be available. The next announcement up on our screen, the next couple of announcements actually have to do with the Back to School Bash. So we will have our final planning meeting on July 16th at 6:30 up here in Holy Grounds. If you weren't able to make it to the first one, please feel free to come to this one as they continue to make those final plans. Know that after this meeting, there will be a host of volunteer things that are going to come out. Which leads us to our next slide, in that we are already asking for whether or not you can help us to feed that Back to School Bash crowd. So remember, we are asking for 300 book bags of stuff. So we know that we are looking for 300 children. Now we have to take into account all of the other people who will be coming with those 300. So if you can sign up, there's things that are easy to bring early. And I'm going to get this out here because before Pastor Steve went on vacation, he was very worried that we would not know what individual bags of chips are. Who thinks he was anxious about traveling on vacation? And not about chips, but this is, we're looking for those variety packs, applesauce in cups or in squeeze things. And we would love for you to sign up. Let us know that you're bringing them. You can actually start bringing those non-perishable items now as we get ready for that bash. And our next slide is about other ways that we can get ready in addition to food, which are the Back to School Bash Challenge items of dry erase markers, highlighters, pencil boxes. Those all can go out into the narthex. I know that we've done a great job so far about gathering in all of those items for the book bags. And I know that we'll exceed, hopefully, those 300 that we need for each book bag of each of those. The end of this month, we will be packing those book bags, so be on the lookout for that the weekend before August 3rd, so that we are ready to go on August 3rd when we will have the Back to School Bash from 12 to 2:30. I think the only other announcement is Pastor Steve is on vacation. He left around the 4th, and he will get back next Saturday, so I want you to notice I leave at 6 a.m. on Saturday. He's not going to get back till the evening late on Saturday. So if you have ever wanted to hear my husband preach, he's actually going to be covering our service on Saturday as we are both in different places and unable to do so. I think those are all of my announcements. So let us stand as we continue with our worship. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share God's peace with one another. Peace. Peace. join in our call to worship based on Psalm 123. As we gather to worship you, O God, we lift our eyes to you in awe before your majesty. We lift our eyes to you, giving thanks for your mercy and compassion.
Gracious is the Lord our God, and great is your grace.
We lift our eyes to you and we celebrate your faithfulness.
Holy is the Lord our God, and great is your grace.
Let us join in our hymn of praise. Pray. God of the covenant, in our baptism you call us to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. Give us the courage you gave the apostles that we may faithfully witness to your love and peace in every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our readings for today.
The first reading, a reading from Ezekiel, the second chapter. A voice said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking with me. He said to me, Mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord. And when they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord. Second reading, a reading from 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such as one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast except of my weakness. But if I wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of their revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness, so that the power of Christ might dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weakness, insults, hardship, persecutions, calamities, for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter. Jesus came to his hometown and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all of this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hand? Is not this the carpenter? The son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house. And he could do no deed of power there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2 and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on 2 tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated, and I invite our child. I just see Evan today. Except we're going to go on a field trip. He totally just rolled his eyes at me. Well, I did ask him earlier if he had worn a swimsuit. Let's go. All right. Big questions. Good news is there is an entire room full of people to help you, okay? When we come to the baptismal font, do you know what happens here?
You get wet.
You get wet! Totally true. Anything else happen? He's like, I don't know what else you're gonna throw at me. What else happens when we come here? All right, what happens?
You get baptized!
Totally true, Nicholas!
You get to be closer to God.
You are closer to God because you become who in baptism? You become a child of God! Absolutely, so in the waters of baptism, we become children of God. And if I'm a child of God and you're a child of God and they're all children of God, what does that make us? Even they are not so sure it's the right answer. It makes us what?
Family.
Family, absolutely. When we come, it is in the waters of baptism where we are joined to this big community or family of believers, right? What else happens in the waters of baptism? Julia, you've had confirmation. What happens in the waters of baptism? You don't know. Okay. So I've not done my job well. Kaylee, you've done confirmation. What happens in the waters of baptism? And we are saved how?
From our sins.
From, my goodness, thank you. From our sins, absolutely. God forgives sin, right, in the waters of baptism, and he grants us the promise of eternal what?
Life.
Absolutely. But if you remember, which you won't from your baptism, but from watching other baptisms, not only is this the place that we come to receive a lot of things, right? We receive that promise of being with this family and God forever, promise of forgiveness, promise of eternal life, promise of the Holy Spirit, but we are also called to do some things. Does anyone know? I'm going to look at them. What we are called to do. What are the promises that we make in baptism? Before we dial a friend. Absolutely. Give me a high five. That's our mission statement, which comes from the promises of baptism. Okay? Nicholas, you had your hand up, or your friend had. Joseph, did you have your hand up? What do we know what we are called to do? So our specific promises, super, super close, but I'm going to use the official words and not your own words, is we are called to live among God's faithful people, to share in the word of God and the Lord's Supper, to follow Jesus' example in our words and our deeds, to proclaim God in Jesus Christ, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Which means that not only in the waters of baptism are we like given a whole bunch of awesome stuff, but there are some things that we get to do. We get to do what Jesus did. We get to tell others about Jesus, and we get to work to bring mercy, compassion, justice, and love to everybody who's in worship and everybody who is in the entire world. It's pretty cool, isn't it? It's a really big job, isn't it? Yeah. But you know what? Who is called to do these things? Are you doing them by yourself? No. Who's supposed to do it with you? The whole family of God, which is not just like this church or that church, but like everybody who's been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, right, is supposed to be doing this big and hard work. I had a question over here.
So if we're doing what God did, does that mean we can't eat for 40 or 40 nights?
You are not called to stop eating for 40 days and 40 nights. That is a great question. You are called to love and to serve your neighbors. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for welcoming us into your family and sending us out into the world to do your work. Give us the courage to love and serve others. In your name, we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up. I appreciate it. All right, so with one child in high school, another shortly to be there, with the hope that they will go on to college, one thing that I keep hearing is that college students are showing up unprepared like never before to do things like clean their room, do their laundry, cook a simple meal, or manage their own time schedules. In fact, in a recent article I read, it said 74% of families who participated in the survey admit that their kids are not completely prepared to clean on their own. This includes their room, doing their laundry, scheduling time in their day to do these tasks, or being able to purchase the things that are needed to participate in cleaning. Even more surprising in this survey, 72% of college students surveyed agreed with their parents, feeling less than prepared to navigate the responsibility of cleaning on their own. Nearly half of all parents predict that college students will bring home laundry expecting someone else to do it for them. More than a third think their college students will wear dirty clothes because they forgot to do laundry. And almost one in four suspects their college student will go an entire semester without ever changing their sheets. So in response, I have begun to work on life skills with my children. We've been working on cooking and cleaning and laundry and hopefully that self-time management as well. And let me tell you, it's a process. It does not happen overnight, much to the dismay of, I'll just watch a YouTube video and know how to do it. It is a process of modeling the skill, of intentionally showing them, teaching them the skill, their own desire to learn this new skill, and then finally letting them do it. First with support, and then more independently. And even more exciting than seeing my children do the skill that I have taught them is when I see them taking out the trash because they saw it was full and I didn't have to say anything, right? What's more exciting than just the skill is when an older child teaches a younger child a life skill, right? See it, do it, teach it, they get it, right? Or the newest thing in our household is independently seeking out a new skill that wasn't even on the to-do teach them list. This process of teaching our children life skills, it is really very similar to today's gospel, where Jesus is getting his disciples ready to be sent into the world to continue his ministry. He has now spent several chapters walking with his disciples, showing them, teaching them what his ministry looks like, casting out demons, healing the sick, forgiving sins, raising the dead, calming the storm. But he doesn't stop at showing them. He goes on today equipping them to carry on God's ministry by giving them some very clear instructions on discipleship. And the first thing that he tells them, shows them, is that they are not to go alone. Jesus, he's getting those 12 disciples ready, and before he does anything else, he pairs them up. Sounds a little bit like vacation Bible school, as we ask our children, where's your buddy? You can't go anywhere without your buddy. Jesus, too, says, stick together. Don't try to go it alone. And we see this as a pretty consistent message. Jesus is constantly creating and restoring communities wherever it is that he goes. When we are baptized, we are joined to a community called the church, where we gather together in Jesus' name to worship, to serve, to have fellowship with one another. Being a Christian is not about being alone, because we need each other. And quite frankly, our synod knows it, which is why their vision statement is stronger and better together, joining Jesus in the restoration of the world. It is why the ELCA has on its website a bit describing who they are, saying, we are church together for the sake of the world. Jesus gathered his disciples. He gathers us together, and then he sends us out into the world together to continue his ministry. The second thing he teaches us is that we need to remember that Jesus is the boss, which means that when we go into the world, we go because Jesus has given us the authority to do so. Jesus is the boss. And he says in the Great Commission, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. We go in confidence, literally with faith, because Jesus has called, gathered, and equipped us, and finally has given us the authority to go out and do ministry in his name. Next, he teaches us that we are to travel light. Traveling light means we are trusting Jesus. It means we already have everything we need to serve the Lord. Jesus has been working to equip us all along our faith journey to go and do God's work in the world, which is to love and serve others. And that doesn't take a lot of stuff. Mostly, it takes us going out into the world, often to the fringes or the margins of communities, and taking time to actually listen to people. And then, in turn, to love them, to pour compassion and mercy out upon them. If our job is to love, Jesus knows that we are supposed to be traveling light. The next thing he teaches us is to not get discouraged. Jesus tells us that when we go out in Jesus' name to proclaim the good news of God in Christ Jesus, that not everyone is going to accept us or this gospel message. There will be some who refuse to hear this message of love. And all we can do is entrust them to God and then to move on. It is not our responsibility to successfully bring God's kingdom into the world. That's God's job. Our job is to go into the world and to love and serve others in Jesus' name. And if we are not welcome, we are to shake it off. No, this is not a Taylor Swift reference. Because quite honestly, Jesus said it first, shake off the dust and move on. The bottom line is that when we go in Jesus' name to love and serve others, we are not to be discouraged when it feels like others are rejecting us or the message. Because here's the thing, God, not us, is the one who was able to turn death on a cross into the greatest victory that this world has ever seen. Next, he teaches us that we should not be afraid to tell the truth. When the apostles were sent out, it was to cast out demons, to heal the sick, but it was also to proclaim that all should repent. Now, the word repent, it actually means to turn away from sin, to turn away from false promises, to turn away from false gods, and turn or return to the Lord. This world, it is quick to offer false hope, false promises, and false gods. It always has, and it always will. And as followers of Jesus, part of our task is to name those idols, to name sin, and then to remind the world that our God is a God who loves and forgives sin and grants us eternal life. Today, Jesus is equipping his disciples for ministry on their own. But what we know is that just like a parent teaching life skills, Jesus doesn't just send them out on them by themselves. He continues to support them as they do this ministry in his name. If we jump forward just a few verses to Mark 6:35, we read, "When it grew late, the disciples came to Jesus and said, 'This is a deserted place, and the hour is now very late. Send the crowds away so that they might go into the surrounding country and villages and buy something for themselves to eat.' But Jesus answered them, 'You give them something to eat.'" He is reminding them that he has given them authority to go and to do ministry in his name. And they respond back, are we to go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat?" And so Jesus shows them again what his ministry looks like, what he has called and equipped them to do. And so with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, he orders the crowd to sit down on the green grass, and he feeds them, all 5,000 plus women and children. And when they are full, what we see is 12 baskets full of leftovers coming back. Jesus was showing and teaching and equipping his disciples and us to be sent into the world to continue his ministry. And so, I am going to challenge you this week, this month, to think about how it is that God is calling you to participate in Jesus's ministry. Maybe it is being a reader or a communion assistant. Maybe it is wanting to join Bob Ritzy and his guitar group where they are learning how to play guitar for worship. Or maybe it is stepping up into a volunteer role or a leadership role with the Bash. There are lots of ways in the next month or two, or even this year, that we can physically, visibly participate in Jesus' ministry, because we have been equipped with these skills: reading, loving, praying, serving. But the reality is, they do us no good if we do not step out in faith and do them in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks that you have given us many and various gifts. Some who are teachers, others who are really good listeners or prayers, some who are really good with their hands, Lord. Help us to see how it is that you have equipped us to be your saints, working for you, Lord, that we might help to build up the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may not only see these gifts, Lord, but that we may do them in your name. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand as we continue with our confession and forgiveness. Drawn to Christ and sent into the world, let us confess our sin. Gracious and merciful Lord, you send us out but we want to stay home. You provide partners for the journey, but we want to go it alone. You give us authority over evil, but we don't know how to use it. You say we need only the clothes on our back, but we pile our SUV full of necessities, including a cell phone charger and GPS to guide our way. You tell us to accept hospitality, but we don't like to put people out. You say that if people are unkind, we should simply shake the dust off our feet, but we would rather get mad and gossip or post on social media. Forgive us our sin. Jesus says, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." Through Jesus Christ's death and resurrection, your sin is forgiven. Go and share the good news. Thanks be to God. Amen. Confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
One in the communion of saints, and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. Please be seated. Let us pray. Glorious God, you bend down to wash the feet of your disciples. Let the servant church arise in our teachings, our praying, our healing, and our doing. Make all your faithful people powerful in weakness and strong in grace. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer. Life-giving God, your fingers trace the heavens and your hands mold the earth. Where there is drought, bring nourishing rain. Where there is devastation from fire or flood, bring relief. Sustain the well-being of every living thing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, you speak and the nations listen. Open those who govern to the cries of all who journey with no food or shelter, particularly people fleeing from violence, those seeking freedom, and those in search of community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, you embrace being wholeness. Your embrace brings wholeness to those who are troubled. Anoint all who suffer in any way with the oil of healing and grant them renewal. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Welcoming God, in your presence, strangers become companions and enemies become neighbors. Open our doors to those who have so easily shut out, particularly people who are different from us or who are marginalized by church or society. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, you gather us into your house of many dwelling places. We give you thanks for our faithful departed. Inspire us by their lives of faith until with them we rest forever at our journey's end. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church family and those we name aloud or silently in our hearts, that all experience the healing and comfort given through Christ. Hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ,
our Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. All are welcome to come to the table. We encourage you to be seated at this time as you gather together your offering and your I Worship Today sheets. We will have a brown chalice with grape juice at the center. We will have our two wine stations in blue cups towards the side. Our ushers will dismiss you by pews to come forward to receive the meal. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. How
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Share Christ, serve community, grow disciples.